Hey everybody and welcome back to another Darkfall video. So today we're going to be looking at version 1.5 of the Darkfall VFX nodes. So if you've missed any of the previous versions, go ahead and click up here and there'll be a link to check the previous one, or there'll be a link to the playlist in the description. But first, let's go ahead and enable the add-on, so providing that you've downloaded it, and if you want to see how to download it, again, check the previous video. But first, let's go to Edit, down to Preferences, then down to Add-ons, and we want to search for the previous version, so let's just type Darkfall. So go ahead and open this up. If it says version 1.4, you need to go ahead and remove it. And then we can go ahead and install 1.5. So just navigate to where you saved this to, select the script, and then go ahead and install it. And then go ahead and check this, and now it's enabled. Now we can close this down. And then we can switch this from the 3D view to the compositor window. So let's go ahead and check use nodes, and also change this to the Darkfall nodes tab. So now in the tools section, we have the 2D planar tool. And then within that, we actually have two options. We have the 2D planar tool, and then we also have the subsurface skin node. So this is very similar to this, except it's a little more specific to the subsurface skin, whereas this is good for general 2D planar stuff. It also has the option for a drop shadow, so if you need to use a drop shadow, then that's a good idea to use that one. But we're going to take a look at both of these. So let's go ahead and remove the nodes. Let's add some additional nodes. So first, let's take a look at the 2D planar tool. So we have these nodes here that's just been added. And then if we connect this movie clip to the movie clip slot, and we can plug this into the output and the viewer node. Let's go ahead and load up a movie clip. And then to see the backdrop, let's go down here and click this button here. So this is the video I'm using. And again, I found this at hollywoodcamerawork.com. I'll leave a link in the description so you guys can check it out. So it's another great clip where the head is moving in different positions and we've got a whole bunch of markers. One thing I would note, if you're recording the footage yourself, you only need four tracking markers. So I'd say this area, this one, and this one. So for the planar tracker to work, it only needs four tracking markers. But since we didn't record this footage, we don't have the control over what gets recorded. So just keep that in mind when you're recording it yourself, just to only add four tracking markers. Also, I would say that these tracking markers are quite big. Blender is great for tracking, and these are far too big. If you notice, she's got pierced ears, and that dot here is actually the size that I would use. And I will show you an example when we do the tracking, but so again, just keep that in mind when you're adding the tracking markers, you don't have to make them too big. So now we have this movie clip, we need to do a couple of things. Let's go over here and add a new workspace. Let's go down to VFX and add in a motion tracking. Now you can close these windows by right-clicking in the center and just closing them, or you could just drag this section up. Since I'm lazy, I'm just going to drag it out of the way. Select this movie clip icon and choose the movie clip that we loaded in. And then we can go over here and set scene frames, which will set the timeline to be the length of our movie clip. But for this example, I only want to use a small section of this clip, so maybe 99 to 180, something like this. So I'm going to jump to the first frame. And then I'm going to click prefetch. So if we play through this, we can see she moves in loads of different positions. The mouth moves, the head moves, there's loads of different things going on. So as I mentioned before, these are far too big and there's too many. So I'm not even going to focus on these outer ones here. I'm going to assume that when you record this yourself or the one that you're working on, there's only four markers or maybe six markers here. So let's go over to the tracking settings. I'm going to change the motion model from location to location rotation. I'm going to change the match from keyframe to previous frame, and then I'm going to enable normalize. Now these are the general settings I use. You can use whatever tracking settings you want, and depending on the footage, you probably will need to change these. But I find for the most part, I generally use these settings a lot. The next thing we want to do is change this to the tracking tab so we can see the tracking markers. And then I'm going to hold control and left click to add a tracking marker. I would like to see the search size. You can also go over here to clip display and just enable it here if you want. Same thing. So I'm going to scale this up a bit by pressing S, then press G, move it over, and then scale this down a little bit. And then I'm going to click copy from active track. So any new markers I add will share the same settings. And then I'm quickly going to click on these like this. And like I said before, these tracking markers are far too big. Blender does a really good job with small areas. I mean, we could actually use this as a tracking marker. This is actually a good size. I'd maybe make it a little bit darker if you wanted to, but I'll just show you that Blender can track this area just as good as it can track this one. So now you've added your tracking markers, press A just to select all of them. We can go down here, open this up, and you can use this panel if you want, or we can use these same icons here. So I'm just going to use this section. I'm going to track these forward since we're on the first frame. So we can see it does a good job, even the section over here. So now we have these, I'm going to jump back to the first frame. If we double tap A, we can deselect everything. Then if we change this to the Solve tab, and then if we open up Plane Track. Now, as I said, if you want to create a plane track, you will need four tracking markers selected. So I'm going to select this one, hold Shift, select this one, and this one. Now if we click Create Plane, we can see we have this box has now been added. And if we play through, it sticks to the face, which is pretty good. Now jump back to the first frame. I'm going to scale this up on the Y, a little bit on the X, and then I'm going to press R to rotate and just put it somewhere like this. So that's the planar done. Now we need to create the area of effect, which essentially is the area on her face, which we want to show this texture or image that we want to put on. So let's change this to the masking tab. We can go over here to tracking and just change this to masking. Or we can press the tab key on the keyboard and it'll switch the windows for us. So in the masking window, we can go over here to the new, create a new mask. And then let's create an area. So I'm going to hold control and click. And I'm just going to add these points to kind of make a shape that looks good. Then we can press A, select all of these. Then I'm going to press V. I'm going to change this to automatic, give this more of a fluid shape, and then come back and refine the areas if you need to. But say we're happy with this, I'm going to press A to select it again. Since you already have the planar track selected, we can see that because it's white. I'm going to hold Control and P. So now this mask has been parented to the tracking marker. So if we can see, it will follow perspective. And we can see as well, since this marker moves a little bit, the actual mask moves as well. In most cases, you don't want the mask to move, but in this case, it actually works. It looks good. It looks as if the skin is stretching. And let's change this back to the general workspace. So now we go over to the planar track deform. We select this icon here, choose the movie clip that we've loaded in. Then if we choose this icon here, choose the camera. Then choose the tracking marker to be the plane track. And if you want, we can enable motion blur. And with motion blur, it will make the effect look so much better. Let's go ahead and add an image. So go to open. So this is the image I'm using, and it's just a leather texture. And if I can remember where I found it, I'll make sure to throw a link in the description. And you can use whatever image you want. And the next thing we need to do is add in a mask. Shift A, input mask. Then select the mask icon and choose the area of effect. And then plug this into the area of effect mask slot. So now we have this, which looks a bit crazy, but there's a couple of things we need to change. So the first thing you see is this black line, which is going to be the drop shadow. If you don't want a drop shadow, you can turn this off. You can click here and turn off the alpha all the way down to zero. And then you can just add the effect that you want. So the first option we can play around with is the mask feather, which is this border edge here. So we want to give this a bit of a feather, so maybe 8. And again, each scene will be different, so depending on your scene, you might need to play around with it, see what works for you. Another thing we need to do, since we added motion blur for the tracking deform here, it's a good idea to add motion blur for our mask. And one thing you should note, the more blurs that we add, the longer it will take to render. So I will be checking this at the end before I render it out. I just don't want it to slow down the computer. So now the next thing we want to do is soften this edge here. So that's the drop shadow inner feather. We can give this, say, 20. And if that's not enough, we can go maybe 40. So that looks pretty good. So now we need to position the shadow. We can see that the light's coming in from this direction and it would hit the face here. So maybe if we move this on the X, maybe minus. Maybe minus 10. And this could be maybe minus 9. That's not too bad. Maybe it's a bit too dark. So let's change this to maybe 0.7 or maybe 0.78. Something like that. Now, if you want to reduce the size, there's one thing you can do. You can tab into the planar node. And if we see here, we have this drop shadow amount. It's essentially a dilate erode node. Right now it's minus 30. If we change it to minus 10, so it goes a lot smaller, it kind of looks a lot closer to the surface. The bigger this is, the deeper the sort of subsurface looks, if that makes sense. So you can play around with this and make it look as deep and pushed back as you want, or make it as shallow and as close to the surface as you want. So one thing I do want to improve in the future, I want to make this option available in the output here. Right now I'm not sure how to do that with the dilate erode node. We can see there's no socket here, so I pretty much need to figure out a way to add a socket and then connect it up. If you guys have any ideas how to do that, leave in the comments below. So now we have this, and if we play through, we'll see it moves and all the shadows and everything looks good. Now obviously we need to get rid of these tracking markers here, so if we jump to the first frame, I'm going to quickly show you how to do that. Let's tidy this area up here, we don't need these now. Then under tools, we go to the marker removal node, and then let's add in the marker removal node. Then just drop this in. Now of course we need a mask to plug into this, so let's change this back to the motion tracking. Now since we're already in masking mode, let's go over here, just add in a new mask. Let's call this marker removal. Then all we need to do is select one of these markers. Then I'm going to left click just to add a 2D cursor. If you're using a different button configuration, you probably need to hold shift and then left click. So once you've added the 2D cursor, you can shift A, add a circle, and I'm just going to scale this down. In the previous tutorial, so I said maybe give it a bit of a gap, but in this tutorial I'm going to tell you to give it a big gap, because these tracking markers are far too big. But now we have these, if we hold control and press P, they've been parented, and we can play through this and see. Now I'm just going to do the exact same thing for these other tracking markers here. And if you want to see in detail how the marker removal is done, there'll be a link up here, just go ahead and check that out. In this example I'm not going to go into too much detail, I'm just going to speed through this and I'll be back in a second. So now we have these, let's jump back to the general workspace, shift A, add in a mask, select the mask icon, choose the marker removal, and then plug this in. So as I mentioned last time, we just need to move this either on the X or the Y, it's entirely up to you which way you move it. I'm going to change this maybe minus 40, minus 44, let's see how that looks. So it is quite noticeable here that it's brighter, so we would need to play around with the brightness and maybe even split it off individually like we would with the rest of these, and then add a new marker removal node and just separate them off. Again, I explained that in the last tutorial if you want to check it out. I know there's going to be some of you who's going to complain that I've not removed these tracking markers, and maybe I'll do it for the final example, but if I don't, hopefully you guys will understand it's not about the tracking removal. If we mute this, we can see that this is before and then this is after. So obviously you want to do the same for the rest of these. I just noticed this one down here, so I'll go back and do that in a second, but you guys get the idea. We have a nice easy effect to add a 2D planar. So let's move on to the next one, which is the subsurface skin node. And I did a tutorial quite a while ago now about subsurface skin, and this kind of will help with that process. So let's just select all of these and get rid of them, don't need them. Let's add in the additional. Let's load in that movie clip again, and then add in the subsurface skin node. Same thing with this, we just need to connect it up. So the image to the movie clip, plug this to the output, and then connect up to the view node. Then the next thing we need to do is go down here to the planar track deform, just as we did before. We just need to select this movie clip icon, tell it which movie clip that we're working with, then select the object, which is the camera, and then choose the tracking marker, which is the planar track. And again, if you want motion blur, make sure you enable it. So now we have this, we just need to do one more thing, which is add in the mask, just so we can define the area of effect. So shift A, go down to mask, and it's the same mask that we used before, which is the area of effect. So plug this in, maybe I should have kept it around, maybe we did need some of the nodes, oh well. Now we have this, we can see we have this crazy effect going on here. So there's a couple of things we need to do. We only have one option on here, which is the mask feather. We can see right now it's a harsh line, but if we change this to say maybe 30, see how it looks. So now we can see it's far too bright, I'm going to select this texture node here, which has been added. Shift A, go to color, then go to RGB curves and drop this in here. Now this will be different for each scene that you work with, and obviously I can't predict which scene you're working with, so if it's too bright, you'll need to just drop this down a bit. Or if it's too dark, you can brighten it up. Again, each scene will be different depending on what you're working with, so it doesn't look too great right now. One thing you should note, this texture node here, if we change this window to the texture node editor, then if we change this to brush, and then select this texture icon, and choose the texture that's been created for us. If we scroll out, we can see where it is. So one thing you should know, I did want some of these options preset, but there's a bug in Blender which won't let me set this using Python. I think they are working on it. I did report this as a bug, so hopefully this will be fixed in future versions. But for right now, we need to go to this texture, change this to hard, and then change this from Blender Original to Original Purlin. Now again, you can play around with these and find something that works better for you, but I find these settings for this example works great. So let's change this back now to the compositor and we'll see what's happened. So now we have this, which I think is a lot nicer. We can also play around with the scale and position by using these values here. And then again, play around with the RGB curves. So we can see it adds a nice subsurface skin effect. And again, we'd need to remove those tracking markers. So you just add a removal node here. And then when you're ready, you can go ahead and render this out by using the render panel. So hopefully you guys will find the 2D planar tool and the subsurface skin node useful. If you do, be sure to give this video a like. As always, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.